I'm here to declare to you, my past is over, I'm in you. Things are made new, surrendered my life to Christ. I'm moving, moving forward.
New theme beginning on today that the Lord have laid upon my heart, and it's tight but it's right. But a new theme that the Lord have laid upon my heart for the next 3 to 4 Sundays that He have asked me to go forward with is simply entitled, Don't Be Stuck on Stupid.
Right.
Don't be stuck on stupid. Oh, I wish I had somebody with me right now. Yes. The Lord has shared with me and He's told me that it's time for the believers to step up, and that there are too many folk in the house of God that know better but are not doing better. I wish I had somebody with me. He told me to come forth and to share that many of the things that we are being afflicted with are things that we have inflicted upon ourselves. I wish I had a few folk over there that was with me right now. I wish I had some preachers that was with me right now. He said that He wants us to understand that we ought to do better because He has given us better. And it is time for the house of God. It is time for every believer to stop sitting back and pouting, and stop sitting back and wondering, and stop sitting back talking about why, and step up to the plate of life and tell somebody that in spite of it all and through it all, the Lord has been good to me. I'm not going to just sit there and act like He has not, and I'm tired of Him. Meaning something has happened to you, or somebody has hurt you, or something has slowed you down, or kept your momentum down. Brother Upshaw is with me right there, and you are saying that no more, not me, that I can get over this thing, I can get past this thing, I can get through this thing. I'm not going to sit here and act like my God can handle it. I refuse to be stuck on stupid. You are serious about not being stuck on stupid, then the first thing that you're going to have to do is you're going to have to get your focus back on God's will for your life. Back on God's will for your life. This word is found in the gospel according to St. Mark in the second chapter. It begins with Jesus returning back to Capernaum. And when He goes back to Capernaum, the Bible says that He returns home. And when He returns home, that the crowds are so intense and the crowds are so large and the crowds are so great that it was breathtaking and mind-blowing. And when you look at the word, it says that the first thing that Jesus does is He doesn't give them His bio. He doesn't give them His fact sheet. He doesn't give them His stats about why it is that He's worthy to be standing there before them. What Jesus does when He goes back to Capernaum is that He begins to give them the word. And somebody needs to hear that today, because when you don't know what to say to somebody, you can always give them the word. And when you don't know how to help somebody, you can always give them the word. When you don't have a word you can say, you can tell somebody that the Lord is my shepherd and I shall not be in wrong. I wish I had somebody. When you don't know how to make it, you can tell somebody that the race is not given to the swift nor to the strong, but to the one that endureth until the end. I wish I had some word folk up in the house with me this morning. Well, He gives them the word, and then the Bible says that after giving them the word, that He's sitting there and He's teaching to them and He's ministering to them, and that a man who was paralyzed begins to be lowered down from the roof, and he's there in the presence of Jesus. And when Jesus looks and he sees this man being lowered before him, he looks and he says, son, your sins are forgiven. And he heals this man of his condition. And when most people read this word and that part of the word, they miss out on two important factors. One is the fact that his friends saw the need that he had, and they saw that he couldn't take care of himself, and so they decided to do for him what he could not do for himself. And we need to understand, when it comes down to the house of God, that a lot of us walk by folk in our household, a lot of us walk by folk daily that are standing in the need of a blessing, or standing in the need of a miracle, and we owe it to them to do all it is that we can do to be a blessing to them. But then the second thing that's tied up in this word is that it talks about how large the crowds were, and that the men could not get in the front, so they had to go up on the roof. And when many people look at that, they just think about the fact that the church was packed out, or the house was crowded, and nobody could get in. But what Mark is trying to say is that it never should have went down that way. You see, the house of God should never have been to the point where somebody that needed help couldn't be in the church. I wish I had somebody. The house of God should never have been to the point where somebody that was standing in the need of prayer had their position blocked by somebody who was already blessed and already filled and already had it all, that the people that were in front of the man should have made room for the man. But because they didn't, he had to go about it another route. Well, I see I'm going to bring that just a little bit more closer to home. The church should never be a place where folk on the outside should be told that there's no place for you on the inside. The church should never be a place where the people that currently hold positions are becoming opposition to folks that want to be blessed. The church should never be a place where you look at what you need so bad, where you are ignoring the needs of the person that is sitting next to you. That the house should never be a house, or the church is not a church if it's operating where you are standing in the way of somebody else. That the people of God ought to always be conscious that somebody else might need something just a little bit more than you do. Every now and then, you got to step to the side, or every now and then, you got to pick somebody up, or every now and then, you got to carry somebody's load, or every now and then, you got to be somebody's burden bearer. Every now and then, you got to wipe somebody's eyes other than your eyes. Every now and then, you got to do whatever it takes to make sure that some know that the house of God is the Father's house, and everybody is broken. Oh, I wish I had somebody with me today. It doesn't matter what you think, if you think you got on you. Only thing that matters is what's up in you. God does not care about where you were last night. God does not care about how many folks you have done wrong. If you are here today and you are telling God, I'm sorry for what I've done, I'm sorry for how I've been, somebody ought to step to the side and make a way so you can get to the altar and get your blessing and get your praise up and get your next level of blessing. Let the house say yeah.
Mark was saying it should never have happened. Then he moves on and he comes up on the Pharisees, and they're sitting there and they're being critical of what it is that Jesus has done. A man has just regained whatever it was that was wrong with him. Jesus has healed this man, and then the Pharisees were sitting there in the best seats, ready to criticize everything. Does anybody know somebody that's always criticizing everything? They want to criticize Jesus over word terminology. And I don't know about you, but when I come to church on Sunday, I have been through hell all week long. I don't know about you, but I get to the house of God on Sunday. You don't know what I've been through. So let me make it official for you this morning. I don't want to hear about all right there. When Jesus leaves Aaron, he comes in contact with Levi. And when he gets to Levi, who is Matthew, he sees one of the most unlikeliest persons in the world. He looks at Levi, who was should have been last on his list, and he tells Levi to come on and follow me and join this party. Right. And the Bible says that as he called Levi to come follow him, and it shows that the next thing that happens is that Jesus winds up at Levi's house. Oh, stay with me. I'm going somewhere with this word today. When he gets to Levi's house, there's a dinner setting there. And what most people don't realize is that when Levi got up from the tax collector's booth, it wasn't like everybody else that had followed Jesus. You see, all the other disciples, they had a traitor. They had a crap. So if they followed Jesus and it didn't work out, they could just up in the day and you don't have your focus. Think about your bills. Get your focus back. Worrying about if they gonna take you back. Get your focus back. Worrying about your future. Get your focus back. Everything about you is in God's hand. Three things in His Word. Because I can hear somebody saying, Pastor, that's me. What do I have to do in order to get my focus back? I'm out of focus right now. I'm admitting that's me and that I'm out of focus right now. So what do I have to do in order to get my focus back? Well, the first thing that you have to do in order to get your focus back is don't go there anymore. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. I'm trying to bless somebody. Look at somebody. Say, don't go there no more. Look at this word. Look at this word. Look at this word. And you will see right here in this word that when they came upon Jesus and they attacked the men, those men were sitting right there within an earshot of hearing everything that was being said about them. When they came and they started talking about the paralytic man, he could hear everything they were saying about him. When they started talking to Matthew, they walked up in Levi's house. Oh, somebody didn't hear me now. That was Levi's house where he paid the nip store. That was Levi's house where he paid the water bill. That was Levi's house where he paid for the DirecTV. And the Pharisees were up in his house talking smack about him up in his house. But when you look at that word, you can't show me one place where any of them ever allowed themselves to be pulled into the stupid or pulled into anything that was being said about them that would make them go there and make them lose their cool. And somebody up in here today, you just needed to hear what it is that I just said, because your biggest problem in life about why it is that you stuck on stupid and why it is that you keep on going there is that you always feel like you got to defend yourself about what it is that morning. You gotta lose your focus. What's going to talk about you? You ain't gotta lose your focus because they're whispering about you. You ain't gotta lose your focus because they're pointing at you. Don't you know that if you weren't doing something for the Lord, they would be talking about you? Put me on your list. Keep watching me because I might be down right now, but I'm on my way up. And the second thing you gotta do if you wanna quit being stuck on stupid and you wanna get your focus back, the second thing you gotta do is that you might need to come to grips that you need a checkup.
All right.
I'm gonna give you all a checkup this morning, amen?
Yeah.
You know how you go to the doctor and you go in the doctor's office and the doctor sits you down and
yeah.
The first thing the doctor do is he tells you to, he or she says, open your mouth wide.
Yeah.
And when they say open your mouth wide, you say, they say, say, ah.
Ah.
That they tell you to open your mouth wide. Next thing the doctor does is the doctor takes the stethoscope and puts the stethoscope to your chest and the doctor tries to check your heartbeat. Am I right, Lord? Put your hand on your heart. I need you to reach over your head. Reach over your head. Reach up. Yeah, yeah. And then the doctor says, if you can. Just fine. Am I right or wrong?
Yeah.
Right, everybody knows what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Come on, give God some praise in the back. The doctor saying, I'm glad you came in today because you needed this checkup. You see, when I told you to open your mouth and I told you to say, ah, yeah, it was some stuff down on the inside of you. It was sounding like stupid stuff that was coming out of you. Some I can't was coming out of you. I can't do this was coming out of you. I'm not qualified was coming out of you. Or he or she left me was coming out of you. And I don't know how I'm going to make it was coming out of you. But I got something I want to prescribe for you right now. I'm about to need you to take this prescription of John. I'm not talking about Father John, but I need you to take this prescription of St. John around the 8th chapter and the 36th verse where it says that who the Son sets free is free indeed. And the second thing he said is that I checked your heart, and when I heard your heart beat. It was beat, but it wasn't beat for the will of God. And so I gotta give you an injection this morning. And see, every now and again, God has to give you an injection right now. I'm not talking about an antibiotic or penicillin, but every now he'll give you an injection of Psalm 62, where it says, trust in the Lord all the time. Owe you his people, and pour out your heart unto him, because God is a refuge. And anybody up in here today that's got a heart problem, you need to know that if you pour out your heart to God, meaning you talk to God about everything that's going on the inside, if you pour out your heart to God, he's a just God, a merciful God, a powerful God. If you pour out your heart to God, he'll make a way out of no way. If you pour out your heart to God, he will answer your prayer. If you pour out your heart to God, he'll wipe your tears stay out. If you pour out your heart to God, he'll visit you in your sickness. If you pour out your heart to God, he'll make them predators do some things for you that they didn't intend to do for you at all. If you pour out your heart to God, he will make the impossible become a reality. So you can tell somebody that the Lord did for me, and the same thing that he did for me, he can do it for you. And there's somebody in behind the four walls that will point out your heart to God. You give him all your hurt, all your pain, all your trauma, all your sacrifices, all your issues, and then the Lord make it all right. When you get your checkup,
yes,
he did.
Yeah.
He said, I seen you when you lifted up your hands, and I seen you when you tried to get to your toes. But it wasn't no joy in nothing that you were doing. So I gotta give you a prescription for some Philippians 4:8. Where I tell you, rejoice in the Lord. Always. I said it, rejoice in the Lord. Oh, somebody just missed that. Because I dare you right now to just start rejoicing in the Lord, in your current situation. I dare you to start rejoicing in the Lord. If you're the person here today that can pay your bills, rejoice in the Lord. If category. Lord have mercy. But we gotta stop praying. You can keep on praying. You gotta pick your category. Jesus said that I didn't come for the righteous. But I came for the sinner. And he was being facetious when he said that. Because what Jesus was saying is that there's nobody righteous except the one that's speaking to you right now. And I came for the one that knows that they need help. And there's somebody out here today. You lost your focus and you know you need the help. Somebody here today, you take inventory of your life and look at your life. Somebody here today, you need to look at the folks that you hang out with and the folks that you call friends. Somebody here today, you need to look at how you run your business and who you got up in your business.
Yeah.
moving ahead. I'm here to declare to you, my past is over. I'm in you. Things are made new. Surrendered my life to Christ. I'm moving, moving forward. What a moment you have brought me to, such a freedom, Lord. I have found in you, you're the healer who makes all things new. Yeah, yeah, yeah.